So, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, a very good afternoon to you all. At the outset, I welcome you all to this second day of webinar. This is a theme, we are a part of this webinar series, which is a theme-based 8 days webinar on the new National Education Policy 2020. So, before I jump to the discussion, let me first run through the policy journey. I feel privileged to tell you that the policy was drafted under the chairmanship of Dr. K. Kasturirangan, who is the erstwhile chairman of ISRO and an eminent scientist himself. He was assisted by a panel of eminent personalities from different sects of life, like education, science, technology, and academia, industry, research, and different philosophies of different fields. And it was in due consultation across the society since 2017, and it has been under due discussion with a lot of experts, such as educators, researchers, policy makers, sector experts, industry people, and community groups, including the common citizen of India, from colleges and institutions. And with such elaborate discussion, the policy was formulated and lastly passed by the parliament in year 2020 on July 29. So we are celebrating the first anniversary of the role of the new education policy. The vision of the policy says, the National Education Policy 2020 envisions an India-centered education system that contributes directly to transforming our nation sustainably into an equitable and vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality education to all. In my understanding, creating a policy which can generate global citizens whose roots are deeply rooted in Indian culture and ethos. The creation of Indian the education system with Indian culture is the prime goal of this education policy in nutshell. Coming to the topic of today, that is multidisciplinary and holistic education, let me just go through the meaning of the multidisciplinary education system. Multidisciplinary education system is a unique educational approach that allows the student to learn and explore distinct subjects or curriculum from various disciplines. In that regard, it gives privilege to the student to choose the subject of his choice. For example, a student of engineering background can opt for one or two subjects across the discipline, such as fine arts or painting or classical singing or classical dance, etc. Even he can go for some other branch of engineering. Suppose a mechanical engineering student can opt for architecture as a subject, and with this he will be given due credit also. In that case, we are facilitating the student and to allow him to discover passion within himself. It is well understood that a young boy, when given the freedom to study of his choice, he will definitely put his heart into the study and will try to excel and will try to discover more, will try to research more, and will think over and ponder over. So he will generate the interesting academic caliber, as well as he will feel interested and devoted for the kind of subject he has taken. Truly, it is his interest which has compelled him to take that particular subject and enthuse him to go ahead with the academic curriculum, along with focusing on the core subject for which he has been enrolled for. Like, as I told in my example, the student is of engineering background. Therefore, it gives the chance to cover more subjects in a defined academic session and gives more flexibility, and it is more pragmatic as far as the educational requirement of the young generation or the growing population is concerned. This idea of multidisciplinary approach may seem new to us, and we have rolled this as a policy today. But let me tell you, this idea is age old, and it has been in ancient India since time immemorial. I feel really proud to tell you that universities like Takshashila and Nalanda are the greatest example of such multidisciplinary education system. Coming to the Takshashila, it really thrills me when I came to know that Takshashila was a part of India, and it was created in year 500. It was created in 800 BC, and it lasted till 500 BC. So there was a journey of 400 years of this Takshashila, and it was the world's first university. Takshashila has a credit of giving scholars like Chandragupta Maurya, Chanakya, and Charaka. Charaka was the father of Ayurveda. Chanakya is well known as a greatest politician and economist, and needless to say about the mighty emperor Chandragupta Maurya. Coming to Nalanda, Nalanda has the same culture and same approach of education, but it is the latest university, but it was still very old, and it was founded in the fifth century. Nalanda has the same setup, but it was more formal with respect to the Takshashila. One of the greatest scholar, Banabhatta, has a very beautiful creation in Sanskrit. It was in fact one of the few novel written in Sanskrit by such old scholars, that says an education system is not complete unless the 64 kalas are imbibed into a human being. Those kalas are not only bound with arts and painting or dance, as we generally feel today that art subjects are just science, just arts, painting or dance or such allied subjects. But those 64 kalas also include scientific fields such as chemistry and mathematics, vocational fields such as dance, art, craft, painting, embroidery, stitching, etc. Professional fields like medicine and engineering, soft skills like communication skill and other aspects of soft skill, including dance, science, and painting. So such holistic it was that included all the facets of life in educational system itself, so that it creates best of human for a better society. So coming to the need of the education system for this century, for the 21st century of India, the overall development of a human is must. The overall development means the development of intellectual aspects, aesthetic aspects, social, physical, and emotional well-being, moral values, all in an integrated manner. So it is not just studying physics, chemistry, engineering subjects, or medical subjects in isolation, but with studies, the educational qualities which has been described since time immemorial, so-called 64 kalas, should also be imbibed, so that creates beautiful women for a beautiful society tomorrow. It has been seen that with multidisciplinary approach, when it was implemented with undergraduate courses, it was found that there was an increased creativity and innovation aptitude among the students. They had better critical thinking, they had higher order thinking capacities, they had better problem solving skills, teamwork was enhanced, communication skill was generated and it was heightened, more in-depth learning and mastery of curricula across field was imparted. It increases the social and moral awareness among the students, besides general engagement and enjoyment of learning. So needless to say, this is a huge benefit of this multidisciplinary approach, where we give more liberty, we are allowing the students to realize their passion, we give them more pragmatic and realistic approach to the educational system, and in turn we generate better human, well educated human and good human for a better society. The institutional restructuring and consolidation. This is the need of the hour, so that the multidisciplinary and holistic approach of education can be realized. As we know, we have lakhs of colleges and thousands of universities spread across India, and they are not interconnected. A college like one which is just giving one discipline education is not at all connected with a nearby college which is giving an education in another discipline. In that sense, the infrastructure, the labs, the sports field, the dormitories, the campus, the auditorium, and the asset of a college, that is academia, is not interchanged, is not benefiting each other, and that creates a huge gap and loss. Therefore, the consolidation of the existing infrastructure into more fruitful, suitable and pragmatic institution is the need of the hour. In that regard, a new vision and architecture for higher education has been envisioned in the policy, with large, well-resourced, vibrant multidisciplinary institution instead of standalone and very old thought institutions existing today. Consolidation of current 800 universities and 40,000 colleges into about 15,000 large, well-resourced, vibrant multidisciplinary education is what is envisioned. So therefore, the existing universities and colleges will be restructured. The restructuring will be based on three major criteria, wherein the first will be pure research institutions. Second will be research and teaching institutions together. And the third will be only teaching institutions. In that regard, the research universities will have equal focus on only research and secondary on teaching. Those universities are already existing, like institutions of national importance like IITs, IIMs, IISERs, etc. These are pure research universities, and more such universities will be created on these lines from the existing universities. Second are the teaching universities, where the main focus is on teaching, along with it research are also going on, and more such universities are needed to be created for this in this direction. And third is autonomous degree granting colleges, which focuses almost only in teaching. So it will significantly increase the research capacity while building strong educational communities. All higher institutions to become multidisciplinary institutions with teaching program across discipline and field. High quality institutions in disadvantaged geographies a priority, and substantial public investment will be attracted. In this case, in our case, in particular, like we are geographically disadvantaged place, and we have almost nine isolated colleges which have expertise in a particular discipline. Some colleges are teaching only engineering, some are medical, some law and other science and other disciplines. These combining together and coming under an umbrella will give more flexibility, will give more power, will give more capacity to the institution as a whole, and therefore the students of these islands will be able to reap and get the benefit of colleges which are beyond the boundary of itself. In this regard, the Takshashila and Nalanda philosophy will also be realized. The policy towards high and quality liberal education, going in that direction, multidisciplinary and holistic education also needs restructuring of the academic coursework. The liberal education with broad multidisciplinary exposure will enrich imaginative and flexible curricular structures, creative combination of disciplines of study, multiple exit and entry points. Master's and doctoral education provide research-based specializations. In that regard, the restructuring of the existing curriculum can be done so that 3 to 4 year undergraduate degree with multiple exit options are available to the students. That says, one student who is enrolled for a 4 year bachelor program, if he discontinues after the first year of completion of his academic work, he can be issued a certificate of competency. If that happens after the second year, he can be suitably issued with a diploma certificate in a particular domain. If he completes 3 years of coursework, then he is eligible for a bachelor degree, and after completing the fourth year of his academic work, he is a bachelor with research. Therefore, if the entry for 2 year master program is done, one with 4 year of research bachelor degree will directly be placed for the M.Tech program, and he need to undergo just 1 year of work. A 3 year degree program student can go for 2 year master program, in which the first year will be purely classroom academics and the second year will be purely research work. Also, there is an option of 5 year integrated program, which is already underway with various universities, and students are taking advantage of it. So in this case, we can clearly see the flexibility has increased and the time and effort put by student is not going waste in any case. At the end of his academic completion, whatever may be the time frame, he is issued with a suitable certificate so as to suffice his requirement, and the years invested in studies cannot go waste due to any good or bad reason. This is a great asset for this new policy. Coming to the optimal learning environment and student support, as we know, any system cannot flourish if infrastructure and suitable setup is not created. Therefore, a university who has been renamed as a multidisciplinary university need to create other infrastructures or can conjoin with other universities or standalone colleges to enlarge the capacity and to offer more disciplines of study to the student, such as creation of other departments of languages, literature, music and philosophy, Indology, art and dance, theater, education, mathematics, statistics, pure and applied science, sociology, economics, sports, translation and interpretation, and other sub-subjects which are of interest and may be needed for the new curriculum, which may be a choice of the new inductee students. Not only this, a subject of choice for a student should not go waste as far as the credit is concerned. A student should always be given credit for what he has studied for, like an engineering student who studies arts or fine arts, or he learns classical dance, should be given suitable credit for the effort he has put in. Further, if a student discontinues for a while and attains a particular level certificate, and if he rejoins, there is a scope, and the new policy has already mandated the creation of credit bank, wherein the student will never need to forego his credits, and credit will be transferred from one institution to the other institution electronically. So this is one of the beautiful point which has been covered in this new education policy. Not only this, the academics should be sufficed with other aspects of educational system values, such as the credit-based courses and projects in the area of community engagement and service, environmental education, and value-based education. When I talk about community engagement and service, this is one of the most important aspect of this new education policy, wherein the student should mandatorily undergo some society or community-based engagement to earn those credits and is required for the completion of the particular course. Environmental education, such as forest conservation, ecosystem conservation, conservation of biodiversity, exploration of new fields of biological interest and conservation, such as soil conservation, water conservation, pollution, etc. These are all environmental aspects which a citizen should understand and can start appreciating right from the beginning, so that really add value to the society at later stage of life. And coming to the value-based education, this is one of the most important aspect which has once again been reiterated. This include the fundamental values, which is more or less related to the Indian culture and ethos, practice of non-violence, satya and ahimsa, the goodness of better citizenship, abiding the constitutional values, respect for the human and society, and many other facets of life which are totally human value based, and it includes the it is in fact a requirement of a human to create a well developed and caring society. And therefore, when we are giving project of such kind to the student, the credit should always be given. That's what the policy says. And students will be assessed not only on academic aspects, but on other values such as the community engagement services, environmental educational aspects, and value-based educational aspects for which the student has undergone some kind of project or engagement. More going beyond this, the support of academic and financial in nature should also be arranged for and has been catered for in this new education policy. And at last, not only this, as we know, the Indian student had a tendency to go for international universities at the cost of very high nature, and it was not really practicable for all students, keeping in mind the economic strata. But with this policy, it has been clearly stated that Government of India has given green flag for setting up of international universities of various domains, and it will happen very soon. So Indian students will not have to go all across for the higher education of such kind. Coming to the professional educational system, which is clearly incorporated with this higher education in this policy, it says this policy also prepares for the professional development, which is must, and it involves an education in the ethic and importance of public purposes, an education in the discipline, and an education for practice. That is a professional. As the definition goes, a professional is one who has different facets, such as he should have moral values, he should follow ethics, he should be an expert of the subject, he should update his knowledge with time, and he should have all the qualities which make believe society that the services offered by the professional is nice and correct. Therefore, not only the educational system is required, not only the academics, I mean to say, is required for creation of professional, but the values such as ethics, discipline, and the importance of public purposes are of high importance while creating professionals. And professional education is an integral part of the higher education system, because the higher education system is the last area of study wherein the students will undergo and will become a better citizen tomorrow. Standalone technical universities, health science universities, legal and agricultural universities, or institutions in these or other fields will be discontinued. So it is needless to say that all such standalone universities will be either clubbed together or will be converted under some other setup, so that it contributes or become a part of a multidisciplinary system. This policy envisions the establishment of multidisciplinary institutions by 2030 latest, so that by 2040 the goal of this new education policy is achieved. In this aspect, I would say this policy has created a vision and has created an option to add value to the educational system. Every era, every decade, every century add some value to the human society, and we as a human need to focus on this so that goodness of today may pass on to tomorrow, and the citizen of tomorrow may be benefited in some aspect by the citizens of today. So that's all for today's discussion of multidisciplinary and holistic education in line with the new National Education Policy 2020. Jai Hind.